Check 1, 2, 3, 4. Paul is late. Paul is
late.
Well,
we'll start with... Paul will join us literally off the street. How's that sound?
P-Mac is coming in off
the street. We're going back to our roots.
Yes.
He's investigating the Joseph Megna situation.
What's that?
That he gets breakaways but gets caught because he's not that fast.
Oh.
That was pretty funny.
I think that is pretty funny.
We can use that as the cold open.
I think we might use that as the cold open.
Oh, you get a lot of shots. Everybody come to their net. We just have to get more and more pucks to their net.
What were you saying about putting pucks on net?
Continue to put pucks on net.
Well, that's the key. We got to get the puck on net.
Pucks on net.
He's got that nick for the net three. Just throws puck on net.
It was nice to get pucks on net.
Pucks on net and driving and making a hard night on him.
Live on tape from Geeta's apartment, her palatial estate on the 23rd floor. This is Pucks on Net, a Vancouver hockey podcast that's not about fantasy or fancy stats. We're reveling in the fact that Evander Kane is not a Canuck today. And, you know, we're just having a good time. Just hope you're thanks for joining us. The Canucks are terrible, but hey, let's just talk about something positive.
Hey. They go hard for 40 minutes.
I was amazed. I didn't know what they were scoring for. I mean, overtime was like 46 minutes away.
Oh, man. You know what? Like, say what you want about the end result. If you were a paying customer last night at the Raj on a Saturday with Chi-Town in town, it was a throwback to when hockey was interesting and cool here.
Chi-town
hey, nobody looked at that 3-0 score and thought this game is over, right?
No, nobody did. And nobody in the building did either. But I'll tell you, for the first 40 minutes, it wasn't even close to how much better the Canucks were playing than Chicago. But when you have that much talent and that much depth, like, again, like, they get rid of Brandon Saad, they get rid of Andrew Shaw, they had these other couple of jabronis out there who I'd never heard of.
Mm-hmm. That handsome guy.
And they scored a bunch of goals, and they looked great doing it. That Schmatz kid, and then the guy who scored those two goals, number 48, can't remember his name.
Fresh out of NCAA,
probably a college ball player that wasn't in anybody else's. Right. And then Scott Darley, pretty good goalie.
I don't know how,
have they only ever played against the backups?
Well, the funny thing is, for like 50 years, since this rivalry started and ended, the Canucks would only play the Blackhawks after a night in Edmonton or Calgary, so they'd always get a tired team.
Yeah.
And so that was the one problem with the one-sided rivalry, because most of the times when you'd go to Chicago, they would, you know, it'd be a legitimate hockey game, but, you know, when they would play here, it'd be a 4-1 Canucks win with Darling or Ranta net or something like that.
You're not pro Ranta, you're anti Ranta.
Everybody's anti Ranta. Like, I can't find work anywhere.
Apparently, well, he's playing in New York with the Rangers.
Oh,
well, he's got a job.
He's going to win a Stanley Cup.
He actually had a really good article in the Players Tribune about his mandatory military service in Finland.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, we got a couple of Players Tribune things coming up on the pod, or another one, because it's a feel good podcast this week.
What do you mean?
Well, we'll get to that. Okay. We got a new dude of the week. It's Russell Wilson.
Why?
We're going to leave the listeners in suspense.
Okay.
All right, now back to that.
Russell Wilson of football is the Pucks on Net dude of the week.
But
why?
How? But how?
You're just going to have to listen.
Should we not get that out of the way before Paul comes here and gets
angry?
Yeah,
that's a good call. Maybe we should get right to it.
No, because Paul also likes the Sonics, and he likes tradition, so we'll leave that.
But Paul hates football.
He doesn't even talk about football. He's just a guy who plays football.
He checks out when we talk about other sports.
Yeah.
The same way we check out when they talk about Harry Potter, which apparently is some of the funniest material we've had on the podcast in years. But I digress.
Don't be such a Hufflepuff.
Whatever that means.
I don't know.
Thanks.
I went outside when I was young. I have no idea.
Thanks for joining us wherever you got us from, because you can get this podcast just about everywhere now. And make sure you follow us on Twitter at PucksNetCA or PucksNetCa. And make sure you like us on Facebook or something, all that jazz. So I was watching the Canucks game last night.
Okay.
When did that rivalry end?
When did it end?
Yeah.
2012?
The Tortorella year when we missed the playoffs.
Yeah.
That was the end of that.
When was the last... Was Duncan Keith's hit on Daniel Sedin, was that after the cup run? Elbow to the head?
No, it was before. It was before.
Mm.
It was
Daniel Sedin injured 2011-ish?
It was 2010. I think it was 2010 when he was injured, because that was the year that Henrik won the Hart Trophy. And the reason that Henrik won the Hart Trophy is because his numbers, against all odds, went up without Daniel. He continued to dominate the league.
Right.
That was, it was 2012.
Oh, was it after?
March? It was in the stretch drive.
Well, then never mind.
So the rivalry ended in 2012.
Yeah, I'd say that because it's kind of sad, like I'm going to just about every GD Canucks game there is this year, and I'm seeing more and more. Like I thought it was just an anomaly that we saw so many Spezza Stars jerseys, but then you go to the Rangers game, and everybody in there is talking about 94 being wit. Oh, that's Boston accent. About the Rangers. And then, like, you go Saturday night, half the lower bowl's red.
And I couldn't believe that Patrick Kane was getting cheap pops all over the place.
Hey, not guilty.
Yeah, every time that he touched the puck, people went crazy. Duncan Keith got booed every time he touched the puck.
Right.
So it's a little confusing. Like, you hate one guy, but you love the other, so therefore you love the team. But yeah, the Go Canucks Go chant was being drowned out last night by Let's Go Hawks, but I digress.
People were really excited about this game. Like, they were all over downtown in their Blackhawks jerseys all day. Like, not just, like, before the game, but, like, from, like, noon on is when I started seeing people. I know that they were protesting the Kinder Morgan pipeline, but then they all went to the hockey game.
You protest the Kinder Morgan pipeline in your Blackhawks jersey. Yeah. You know, then you just go to the game. You look the part.
I was at the Score on Friday night, and there were two women wearing outdoor game Nick Jalmerson jerseys. So I'm like, they're coming out of the woodwork because of these cheap tickets.
I had a really terrible interaction with a woman in a Winter Classic jersey last night, actually.
Oh?
I took the stairs because I didn't want to wait for the elevator when I was leaving the press area last night. And she was just standing there on her phone texting with her girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it was a Jalmerson. I think it was a Taves.
Okay.
But it was the white one with the black.
The giant everything on it?
Yeah. And I was like, and she's like, I'm like, there were like four people behind me. Ian McIntyre was behind me and a couple other reporters. And I was like, excuse us. We're just trying to get out. And she's like, well, I guess I should move because, you know, I'm fucking in the way. And I'm, you know, but like, you know, you guys can't just wait for a woman and like all this stuff. And like, I don't know who the guy was. I think he was a reporter, and he was like, "You're standing in the way of the stairwell, and there's like 10 people."
This has nothing to do with gender.
He just went, "What's wrong with you?" And then she stepped aside, and we went down, and then she tried to actually follow us through the security area to go out, and I shut the door.
He said, "No thanks."
In that contingent in the back was Chris Tanev, who thought the whole situation was rather funny.
Was he greasy looking?
He always is kind of greasy looking. But he's a big man.
Yeah?
Yeah.
When did he... there was some one point in his life where he just decided, I'm going to be Brent Sopel.
And stop cutting his hair?
And just stop looking... Yeah, just stop showering or just putting olive oil in his hair all the time.
Ironically, I had to go back upstairs because I left my umbrella.
Mm-hmm.
I had to double back for it. And I rode back down with Alex Biega, and these women were... This man and this woman were just like slagging the Canucks, like these drunks from one of the suites.
These guys suck.
Oh, what's wrong with them? And he was like, you know, blow a 3-0 lead against, you know, and the guy was like, it's they're a Stanley Cup winning team. It's a big
Cups.
He's like, that's the way she goes sometimes. And they're like, well, yeah, what would you know about it? And I just leaned in. And I was like, he plays for the team.
Not really.
He's
associated to the team.
He's a good guy. I like Alex a lot. He's up there a lot. I'm sure P-Max sees him all the time. He sits right in front of P-Max.
Yeah, they're probably buddies.
Yeah, probably.
He's probably hitching a ride with him into town.
Yeah.
I've brought this up before, but with how good the Chicago Blackhawks are and how they bring in these guys out of junior and they become superstars.
Well, not junior. They sneak them through Colgate University and Rhode Island Tech. Like, we don't even know where these guys are coming from.
But they bring them.
Troy Stetcher has been to frat parties with all of them.
Troy Stetcher wouldn't. Oh, man. Troy Stetcher looks like he's about 14.
I noticed a couple.
He was on After Hours.
I noticed a couple of things about him last night. There's a. The book is out on his little move where he kind of drops the shoulder and, like, the
Jamie Benn.
Yeah, that was. I think the video is out because he tried it like four or five times last night. And Jonathan Taves was like Dikembe Mutombo would just swat it down and waving the finger like, Yeah, so, you know, it's like a little video game cheat that you try on your buddy and then they figure it out. Like, he tried that move like three or four times.
Well, because
last night.
He only knows, he's only known college ball where the only footage of games is, you know, iPhone.
It's 4x3.
Vines.
It's grainy as shit.
I got a handful of vines I want you to study for the next game.
What did he do against the University
of Denver? Well, that's obsolete.
Just like that move.
Yeah. So,
This was, but anyway, like, that team is so, like, those four guys on that team are so good. Like, if I was a player that somehow, if I was Artem Anisimov,
yeah,
I would just say, if my goal is to win and make a reasonable salary, I wouldn't want to leave Chicago ever. I'm like, let's pay me what you want, because I'm going to be Brandon Saad and go to Columbus, and a year later I'm trade bait. So,
well, he's been a healthy scratch over there in Columbus.
Torts don't like him.
That's a quiet story that no one's talking about, by the way.
What's that?
Is that the Columbus Blue Jackets are good.
Oh.
Real good.
I don't know why. Why?
Why they're good?
Because 20 years later, it was going to catch up to them.
They're going to win a Stanley Cup before the Canucks. Is that what you're saying?
Probably.
Everybody should.
They've got goaltending. They've got defense. They got guys who can score. They're actually not a bad team at all.
Yeah.
And Torts has somehow got them to, march behind him, and they're listening to him.
The dressing room's nice and clean. Jack Johnson cleans up all the Coke cans. And he needs the deposits for the 5-10 cents because he's got no money.
Is it because it's a team without large egos and personalities?
Well, they traded their largest ego, and that being...
Dick Rash?
I wouldn't call him an ego.
I was saying Ryan Johansson.
But I mean, the personalities that were in Vancouver under Tortorella compared to what's in Columbus.
Well, Tortorella was the first to say what we all eventually realized 2 years later, that the core of that team was stale. And you'd think, who could that possibly be? Because he's not going to go out and say, like, Kevin Bieksa and Ryan Kesler had to go.
Right.
But he doesn't have that problem in Vancouver that he has, he doesn't have the problem in Columbus that he had in Vancouver.
He's got a young core. He's got, Foligno's going to have a lot of good years ahead of him, and the veterans they do have aren't done yet. Like Scott Hartnell is still contributing.
Mm-hmm.
And they have.
But
Seth Jones is
having
good.
Seth Jones and Ryan Murray is pretty freaking helpful.
Yeah.
And Bobrovsky in net.
They're building that core, and it's looking good. And I mean, they had a pretty high pick last year.
Yeah.
And good for them.
And there's guys they developed in their system too, like Atkinson is a homegrown guy. So is Matt Calvert.
Got a puck in the face last.
Oh, no.
Did you see that?
Is he okay?
But they put this like comical like head bandage around him, like you would see in the movies.
Emoji.
Yeah, totally. And he throws his helmet back on, puts his bucket back on, goes out there in overtime,
scores the winning
goal, and wins the game.
And I loved.
So if it wasn't for Russell Wilson, I would say that Matt Calvert would have been the dude of the week.
You know,
honorable mention for Matt Calvert.
Mentioned dude of the week, and he was like, Saturday night was like the classic coach's corner,
right?
And he's just like, you think they breed him tough in Manitoba? Matt Calvert out of Winnipeg, like huge, like it just nicked, like it got under the visor,
yeah.
So he got the compression
bandage,
yeah. So he got just gushing blood,
okay,
out.
Yeah.
And he has the most comical, cartoony hockey player Jacques Plante stitches right in his forehead.
It's a 1950s zipper job.
It is a classic. Like it's, and then he's just like, make sure you put the cocoa butter on there. It's not gonna scar up. And hey, if Don Cherry believes one thing, it's cocoa butter.
It made me think of. I used that when I had my zippers 3 years ago when I took 7 up here, and it was a through and through, which was really gross.
Mm.
Like I could stick my tongue through.
Oh.
And I remember that. So, good friend of the show, Dr. Chris, took my stitches out a couple of days early, like Don Cherry said, and I bought the cocoa butter.
Yeah.
No scar. Like very little, very faint. If I shave my face, like it's just like a very thin line.
Oh yeah.
Mm.
But it was 7. It was 7 on the outside and it was 6 on the inside.
Oh, that's brutal.
Ouch.
Yeah.
I've never had to get stitches.
Knock on wood.
My poor wife has had to watch a lot of horrible things happen to me in emergency rooms. She always says that she's never going to show up. Like, I'll go, like, without her.
She comes to the most gruesome part.
No, she's like, I'm not coming this time. You need to quit playing hockey. But she can't help herself. She's so supportive.
Right.
That here, and, like, I'll be about to go in, and then all of a sudden, boom, she comes through the door with her iPad and a book.
All right, get stitched up.
She's like, all right, I'll be here. She's like, I'm like, aw.
Aw.
Good beer league wife. But, we aren't talking enough about the Columbus Blue Jackets. They're fabulous.
Well, they're not on our list of things we hate on the podcast, so we could talk about them a lot.
I know what I hate, and I don't hate them.
What do you hate?
What do I hate?
Yeah.
There's a lot of things about the NHL that I hate right now. You know what I did hate last night?
What?
Was with 1.5 seconds to go in the game that Alexi Emelin hit.
Oh, yeah. On James Van Hockey.
Yeah. Holy smokes. Like...
You know, you. I mean, like, there's 2 seconds left in the game.
Yeah.
You're, what, 3 feet from the...
Pin it on the boards. Okay, maybe that's his play. Like, I don't care if I get a penalty because there's, like, 1 second left. I just need
It's a dirty play.
It was dirty. You know, I know Cherry went off on it on Coach's Corner.
Mm-hmm.
But it's just unnecessary. And it's always Emelin on the Habs.
He is of a mean streak there.
I like both those teams. And apparently, I was prepping for the Canuck game last night, but I had it on mute on the TVs. And it looked like it was a good game, and everybody was saying it was a really good, hard-fought Hockey Night in Canada 2-1 game.
59 minutes and 58 seconds of a good, great hockey game.
Good to great hockey game. I just like, Emelin is slow and dirty and takes a lot of stupid penalties. Why is he still on that team? Why is he still in the NHL?
I don't know what his points are like this year.
He doesn't get a lot of points.
We can look that up.
He's a big, slow...
But he's regular. Oh, did you see Matt? Oh, and there was also Matt Calvert's hit.
Yeah.
Or sorry, not Matt Calvert. Matt Martin.
Matt Martin.
Matt Martin laid out. I think it was. I can't remember. But it's just there was a couple moments in that game of just stupid, dangerous by the boards penalties.
Yeah.
Well, Gita looks up Alexi Emelin's stats
for the 2016-2017 season. Yeah. 19 games played. 1 goal, 3 assists, 4 points, and +6.
Oh, there he made +6. Well, you know what he is too? He's a deterrent. Like you see him come over the boards, you're gonna skate a little bit more gingerly. You're gonna have because you never know what he's gonna do because he's psychotic.
It's like the reverse. It's kind of like the Nikita Triamkin thing.
We were talking about at the rink. We were talking about Kadri.
Yeah.
And I was mentioning the Jonathan Tavares comparison that he made, which got a lot of laughs at the buffet table.
I love that comparison.
Somebody,
when did he make it and why?
It was last year or the year before. Somebody brought up the fact that Tavares' contract is up at the end of next season. And the same kind of Stamkos, like, is he going to the Leafs hype is going to start pretty soon with Johnny TT.
Well, it would be a lot. I think that would be a more realistic hype considering how much better the Leafs are, well, on paper than they were last year.
And how the Islanders are playing in a rink that's horrible for hockey.
Oh my God. There's like, I love
it. And they're not progressing. They're not taking the next step after they made
the
playoffs.
Are they never moving?
It's temporary in some capacity. I think they're, what's going to happen is they'll just move to one of the Arizona Coyotes 50 stadiums that they can, you know, they're not using. They're collecting dust down by the highway.
I think that
it's like Monopoly.
There's two scenarios in place that will allow them to get out of Brooklyn.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Scenario one is that they're going to build a new arena in Long Island.
Yeah.
And there's been talk about that because the fan base, they're not making new fans. The fan base is commuting
45
minutes.
Is there space for it? Why don't they build an arena in New Jersey?
Like
the football teams. The New York football teams play in New Jersey.
I've been to Long Island. There's plenty of space.
Okay.
Long Island is strip malls.
They got a lot. Just tear down the one of the Baskin Robbins and the Target and just put a rink there.
It's strip malls and suburbs. It's affluent. Like it's Coquitlam.
Okay.
Long Island is Coquitlam. Right. It's nice houses. And Home Depots.
Yeah, like long time listener of the show, Andrew out of I think the Bronx. He is an Islanders fan, and he says it's ridiculous to go from the way he used to go from Brooklyn to Uniondale compared from the Bronx to Uniondale compared to going to Brooklyn is just ridiculous.
Yeah,
it's a challenge for Islanders fans. And if you watch an Islanders home game,
because
there was one on TV the day before, I believe, and they spend half the game talking about how terrible the ice is because it's bad ice.
Yeah, the commentators will.
It's
right.
Like,
I was watching the Florida Islander game.
The what game?
The Florida. And Denny Potvin, friend of the show. He is a low life.
but a loyal listener.
Yeah, was like if you ever listen, it's just they talk about how the players were complaining about the ice in the morning skate. So scenario two, which is really funny. Jay-Z and his Russian business partner,
Pavel Bure.
They've invested a bunch of money into the Nassau Memorial Coliseum and they're doing massive renovations.
That's
to it.
True. Yeah. I've
so there's even talk of them moving back to that building.
There
once
are,
it's been fixed up.
There's a couple problems and I don't know if people are talking about this as much, but after their $1 billion renovation, I'm very certain that they're going to shut down and tear down Madison Square Garden in 15 or something years to expand Penn Station underneath it.
Oh.
So they're going to be putting a lot of hockey teams just, you know, on a floating garbage barge or something.
There's been two or three Madison Square Gardens. It wouldn't be the first time they've torn down Madison Square Garden.
Yeah,
they'll build a new rink and they'll call it Madison Square Garden.
Yeah.
Right.
I think the Rangers stay in Manhattan, though.
Yeah, they'll just
they'll find a
they'll
way.
Put some seats around the outdoor rink at Rockefeller Center.
They've always been there. Like, they've never been in another city.
No.
In that area.
No, they've always been close to the theater district. Yeah. I think the thing about New York is that there's always buildings that are ready to crumble and come down. So
Trump Tower.
Yeah. So, did you guys hear that he wants to stay half the time?
Yes.
He wants to stay.
I just read an article this morning. Paul's here.
Oh, that's cool.
About Melania and Baron living in New York.
Baron von Trump.
He named his son Baron.
Well, I think that son's a rental. I think that one is that the spawn of Melania.
Yeah, that's the spawn. They won't move.
The one that was too tired.
They won't move to Washington and live in the White House because they don't want to disrupt his schooling.
I actually felt bad for that kid because it was pretty late. Like, it was like 3 a.m.
Yeah,
he's 10.
And they put him in the. I wouldn't put him in the shot.
You know what? I think that the right. I think just about every outlet. I hear I sound like Trump, but like the right wing media outlets would zoom in because they could see that this kid is. Can fall asleep, but like CNN is just like, I want that guy perfectly in frame. So I mean, I've seen multiple shots
where he's like eye rolling and stuff.
Yeah, but like I've seen versions where like other cameras are zoomed in. It's like if I was an unbiased director,
yeah,
and I was like, maybe we should zoom in. This kid looks like he's about to have a seizure.
Yeah, I'm like, yeah, it'd be crap. But yeah, if I was like, yeah, I want to make him look ridiculous.
Yeah.
Speaking of Trump and hockey, he was him and his ex-wife were very prominent Rangers supporters.
That's
during
true.
The 94 Cup run.
Mm.
And he's featured on the Canucks 10 Years Later DVD.
I saw that.
talking about his love for the Rangers, how Mark Messier is a winner. and yeah, he was there at Game 7, so... You know, there you go.
He was such a personality then. That was about the time he filmed Home Alone 2.
Yeah, and he told him where to at the Plaza Hotel, where he could go find the lobby.
I'll tell you where to go, kid. this is because we're recording. I'll wait for.
We were watching Sex in the City.
Yeah,
and yeah, he was in an episode of that too.
Was he really?
Yeah,
I don't remember which episode.
Yeah, he flirted with Samantha.
I just want to get to a question from Twitter because this is a good one, and it more asks about the fan base than the team.
Mm-hmm.
But old Rob Duckworth, quack quack.
Is there a fan base still? I saw a lot of empty seats last weekend.
I've seen a lot of empty seats and a lot of Rangers sweaters the last week. He asks. Does the Canucks jersey get thrown on the ice this season?
No, because it hasn't been 10 years of this. We were in the playoffs a couple years ago.
Yeah.
And we haven't been sold a bill of goods like the Oilers fans were.
These guys are going to have Stanley Cup rings. They don't know what to do with them.
Like, no one ever promises a Stanley Cup, ever.
Well,
Oilers fans were told by anybody that would listen that it was the second coming of Mess, Gretz, Curry, and Anderson.
And that's fine. And I'm sure that's the same lies that Toronto fans get fed. But no one ever tells us that the Canucks are going to be a winner or they're going to bring the cup to town.
No, and Bo Horvat, we were told, was the second coming of our favorite son, Trevor Linden. But Trevor Linden was never that great. So
yeah, exactly. So we were like, we're content.
Yeah, the second coming of Trevor Linden is another guy who gets 20 goals and 50 points and works his ass off.
And he looks good doing
but we're not expecting Bo Horvat to get 100 points. Like they were expecting Ryan Nugent-Hopkins and
150 points, at least 93.
Is that kid still in the league?
He's turning into a really solid two-way center.
Okay.
The Nugent Hopkins is actually he's actually a success story to a certain degree.
Yeah.
That he has he's gained all the weight. He's up to 200 pounds.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, because that was his big problem.
He's good
for
on
years.
Face-offs, and he's a good, solid, like, I think his point totals are going to go down, but I think he's going to be a more well-rounded player.
Okay.
And he should understand that with look who's playing in front of him.
You know who didn't kind of capitalize on his World Cup hype was Draisaitl.
He's playing a bit of a two-way game,
He's been a bit quiet. The Oilers snapped out of a five-game losing streak last night, and Connor McDavid had his first hat trick.
Yeah, and you know who just entered the podcast?
Off the street.
Paul.
Oh.
He was investigating the Joseph Megna situation.
What
is the Joseph Megna situation?
Well, you were investigating. You should have. He's really, he gets breakaways, but he gets caught every time by the defense. It happened 3 times last night. Where he broke away and got caught.
Sounds like a bad game of Red Rover.
Skilly's kind of been doing that kind of stuff the last few games, too, where he looks like he might actually, but then no, he doesn't have the hops.
Yeah, or he gets himself into a scoring opportunity by making a really good play and then kind of blows it. He's Charlie Conway. He's Spazway. He'll screw it up.
Well, get him behind the bench.
and just wearing an oversized jersey.
Conway was a way better coach than he was a player.
That's true.
Jack doesn't have enough skilly.
Paul, this is one of the questions that came into Twitter, and I'll chime in too, but I'm just, this is what we're talking about. Does a Canucks jersey get thrown on the ice this season?
Do people care that much?
That's what I said.
It's a fair wet. Listen, I am a Canucks fan through and through. Mm-hmm. I'll cry for days when they win if they win the Stanley Cup, and I watch every game. But I don't really care that much.
But here's
we are a fair weather fan base.
But here's the difference too: is like we have to pay. All of us are paying thousands of dollars a month in rent. We can't afford to just throw a $200 jersey on the ice. This isn't Edmonton where like everything's free.
And are you sure we're fair weather? Because we're in it and they're not good.
We're in it, but we're not going to go out of our way. Well, I mean, we'll watch the games. We want the team to do well, but
it's
we're not.
Great background noise.
I'm at almost every game, but I'm getting paid. PMAX.
And so. I'm at almost at every game, but I'm going for free.
Well, you're living the Grizzlies life.
Oh, I am loving
your
it.
Attendance of Canuck games this year was like my attendance of Grizzlies games in the mid to late 90s when just any Tom, Dick, and Harry in my life would just be throwing me seats.
Just a little side note from last night's game. I don't know if Dave remembers, but like I think when it hit 3-0, I leaned over. I was just on the other side of the box because we're in two separate rooms.
Really?
And I was just like, what the hell is going on?
And I'm texting Paul. I'm like, who are these guys? And Paul's like, it's more like the Portland Winterhawks.
Yeah.
And that was the beginning of the end.
We got cocky.
Anyway, yeah, no, that was kind of interesting. I kind of was trying to get a gauge for some of the fans last night. I don't know if you guys mentioned the tweet. I had the jersey foul.
Oh, yeah. Good jersey foul.
It was on the bus.
Oh, that was fantastic.
What was the jersey foul?
It was a guy with a little kid. Fouls. I don't know if it was his son. It was cute because they were like talking the whole way. Like, I used to work there and I used to go to school here. And then when he gets up, he had this 55 Sedin's jersey. 22 plus 33.
I see what he's doing
it's
there.
It's not it's a foul. But
I thought it was really economical. I was like, that's smart.
One.
Yeah.
I thought it would be more of a negative thing. Like, I didn't hate it, but I was kind of like, I'm more of a purist. All of the jerseys I own, they've got like
McClellan 69 on
the back. Did you ask him if he was their dad?
No, I took a photo and I tried to crop the kid out of the one I posted, but I was like, I'm not going to say anything. This is kind of creepy already.
It's like I can't decide which one's my favorite. I'm just going to combine them.
There really is like a very strict jersey etiquette out there for hockey fans. Like that's a real thing. There was a good one last night. I looked over into the alumni suite while I was working the game. And the alumni suite was really well stocked last night with notable alums. Garth Butcher was in there. Darcy Rota, who played for both
teams.
Must
have been a good meal.
Was in there. Gino's there every night.
Lambshanks. It was Lambshanks.
It was good.
I didn't get one.
It was the next best thing from ribs. And I didn't text you. Usually I text Paul if the food's good, and I forgot.
They've got a Twitter account now, so I know.
Okay. Because Paul's always told me, he's like, hey, if the dinner's good, let me know. Give me the heads up, and then I won't eat before, and I'll buy it. And it's been a bit hit and miss this year. Anyway, the alumni suite was well-stocked. Like, Babich was in there, Butcher, Ojic, Rota. And then I looked over.
A lot of guys that played for both teams.
Yeah. And then I looked over, and there's a guy in the alumni suite wearing a Linden 94-era jersey.
Okay.
But the bottom...
Was it Trevor?
No.
Okay.
The bottom bar was white. Like, it was like yellow, red, you know, it's supposed to be black.
Yeah.
It was white.
So it was a fake jersey?
I'm like, you're wearing a fake jersey in the alumni suite?
Oh.
What is wrong with you?
I hate fake Canucks jerseys.
I hate everybody that wears them. And we did the policy. This might be an overshare and I might get in trouble. But the policy is now in effect that if you're wearing a fake jersey, you're not doing any of the fan contests.
And that's all Dave and our chatter.
If you're at the games, here's
it came up in a meeting.
Good.
If you're at the game, if you're at a Canucks game, walk around and play the drinking game. Take a drink every time you see a counterfeit hockey jersey.
Yeah.
You will
get... Or take a photo and tweet it at us.
You'll get thrown out like I did in grade 10 with drunk Uncle
Tom. Anyway, just to finish the point why I brought up the jersey in the first place, the Sedin's 55, I thought it would be negative feedback. Overwhelmingly, I think one was like a I don't like it tweet. Yeah. Everyone else was like, oh, that's awesome. And explaining to me, like, you add 22 and 33.
One guy was like,
well, let's go around the horn. Geeta, you yes or no?
Yes.
No, I wouldn't do. I have a Henrik Sedin.
Oh, I wouldn't wear it.
I have a Henrik Sedin Sweden jersey with 20 on the back. Like, I was trying to be authentic because he always used to wear 20 for the national team. I'm one that, like, yeah, if you buy a jersey, I want it to be legitimate.
Yeah, I agree with that. But I'm like, on somebody else, I find that amusing.
Do you mind it?
Yeah. I didn't hate it, but I wouldn't do it.
I think it's a clever idea. It's not the worst jersey foul, but I wouldn't do it.
Yeah, like, well, didn't you have a jersey idea for if they had won Game 7 in 2011, you were going to get...
Whoever's
like,
got the game-winning goal, I'd buy that one. I don't care if it was...
But weren't you going to put, like, the number 11 on it for 2011 or something?
No. Why would I do that?
I don't know. It's like, and my brother is a big fan of Pucks on Net and a huge supporter, and I love him for it.
He didn't buy a shirt. He can kiss my ass.
Well, whatever. He owns the other two shirts.
I don't think he does.
Thanks, Craig. You know, appreciate it. But since we're on the jersey foul, I remember once he came home with, he bought a jersey, made himself the captain, and put his
bit of a stretch.
And put his youth soccer number on it.
12.
And it almost tore our family apart.
Well, you got to first off, you got your own name on the jersey. Secondly,
it was
a retired number.
It was an expensive investment.
He made himself captain.
So, like, you know, in Craig's defense, and Craig, again, I know you're listening, and we're not slagging. In his defense, the goalie was the captain at the time, so it was kind of a free-for-all.
The C stands for Craig.
you could say that Craig's jersey foul was less egregious than what the actual team did by making Roberto Luongo the actual captain.
We don't want to make Willie Mitchell the captain. Like, he chatters too much.
But yeah, my brother had a couple of jersey fouls. That one was amusing, but he was pretty upset with me because I just, as soon as he came in the house, I started laughing. And there is the other one. The other jersey foul was that we were at the Shark Club and we were hammered one night. The two of us were at the Shark Club watching the Canuck game, drunk. And Craig's of smaller stature than I am by a considerable amount. I tower over him by about 7 or 8 inches.
Really? Because you're not a huge guy.
Craig's, you know.
He's Brendan Gallagher to Shea Weber here.
Okay.
He's a spark plug.
Nothing wrong with that.
He's Brian Trottier. He's got a great center of gravity. Anyway, he wins. He's like... We've had a good time. Him and I were having a very nice night. We've had a few adult beverages.
Yeah.
With some friends from work, you know, we're feeling good. We had these raffle tickets. They were giving away Canuck swag. This was like right in the 2006-07, yeah. Like when the Luongo first showed up and they were starting to win a lot of games.
Okay.
He wins a hockey jersey. He wins it. It's a Roberto Luongo jersey. It's got all the bells and whistles. It's got the straps. It's an authentic jersey.
Oh.
It's just before the new ones. It's the dark blue. The first year with the old shitty colors.
Okay.
The Messier colors, if you will.
Mm.
He's hammered. Like, he's so drunk. And he wins this thing. And he puts it on. And it's a dress. Like, it goes down to his ankles. Oh. He takes it off. He's like, here you go. And he throws it to me. And I'm like, are you sure? Like, this is a nice jersey. Like, you can get it framed. Like,
it's an authentic jersey. It's a lot of money.
Like, are you sure? He's like, yeah, take it. I love you. You can have it. He's like, it's a sweet moment. And I'm like, all right, sweet, awesome. Like, thanks, man. So the next day, we wake up Sunday morning, hungover.
Yeah.
And we wake up, he just a little knock on the door. He's like, you want to go to there's like a pub called the Rusty Spur that him and I would walk to and go grab brunch. He's like, you want to go grab some food? I'm like, yeah, okay. He goes like, did you win a hockey jersey last night? I'm like, yeah, I did. I did win it. He's like, did I win it and give it to you? I'm like, are you sure that you won it? I'm like, no, man, that's crazy. You wouldn't give me a hockey jersey for no reason. but then a couple hours later, he's like, I did give it to you. And I'm like, do you want it back? He's like, nah, what's done is done. Yeah. So I do appreciate that. But the two jersey fouls was his own name on the back and then like giving away an authentic Roberto Luongo jersey the first year he's on the team to me.
I'm on a bit of a quest right now and I want to come across the shittiest counterfeit jersey somebody can find on the internet.
Yes, tweet it at us. If you've seen a really terrible one. And last night,
worse than the standard one, because I think there's one print that's pretty standard.
Yeah. Is the Canucks jersey the hardest one to counterfeit because of all the lettering and that weird font?
It's more obvious, I think. Mm. And the color is always horribly off.
And like the whale, but what they seem to get wrong is that the color of the whale is actually black.
Yeah,
but they'll make it the same color as the jersey. Like it'll be white with the same blue in the inside. But if you look at it closely, it's black.
So
like,
if you
the logo is black.
If somebody can come across
a darker navy blue,
and it's like $30, I'll buy it. I want to see the crappiest counterfeit jersey. I want you to find.
We're not buying it.
Put
Come
a name.
On.
No, yeah,
don't
we should
support
buy it.
The system.
What if I get Chap 69 on the back?
No, cheapskate and then .99, 99 cents. I just see it and I cringe. And there's a lot of people at the games like, you're not fooling anybody.
It looks like they sewed it together like before the game.
It's way more fashionable just to get a jersey for the same price.
This is a question that came in on Twitter last night from Yerky21. And I texted it.
From Yerky Lume?
Yes, that is the one.
Wow.
And he asks, which NHLer should go uniquely by his first name like a Brazilian soccer player? And the first option clearly is just Austin.
Yeah.
Austin. Austin's got the puck.
But I think that if somebody would go by just their last name that didn't have a first name, it'd be DeKaiser.
DeKaiser.
What's his first name?
Danny.
Oh. I think Bo could do it.
Just Bo?
Bo.
Al, our PA announcer.
Bo!
He's doing it awesome. It's like the new Trevor Linden.
I'm going to do an impression of it because this is what it sounds like. Vancouver goal scored by number 53, Bo!
That's a terrible impression.
That's terrible. It's not at all what he's doing. It's not even
Orvat.
Close.
You do it.
There's like a fade in it.
I'm not going to try to, yeah.
Okay.
Orvat.
And what I like about it is he's doing it the same way that his predecessor did it. He's not selling every name like it's a freaking tractor pull.
Isn't it Calgary?
In Calgary, it's ridiculous. It's like, oh my God! Sean Monahan! Second assist!
Fuck
yeah!
England!
It's like John McCain trying to rally the troops after he's lost a primary.
I still remember that they did the season opener and they led the house mic on.
Yeah.
And you think like the Toronto Maple Leafs guy does an animated voice, but he's the son of the Toronto goal scored by number 93.
I love that guy.
So his
hell, he didn't give a shit.
And his son is just like, Toronto goal scored by number 34.
Yeah.
And it's not.
You do that guy pretty well.
Thank you.
It's all the Leaf games we grew up watching because they were on every week.
They still are.
They still are.
I like that Al saves it. He sells Horvat pretty hard.
Yeah.
But it works. And last night, like that goal was fabulous. And you knew so many breakaways get missed. When Horvat's coming down, I'm expecting him to score.
Should he be playing more?
I think they should play him as much as humanly possible. He might be their number one center right now.
Is he their best player?
Right now?
Yeah.
I think he is.
Yeah? The Sedins are still putting up a lot of points.
Oh, no,
they're having a good...
It's not saying anything against them. It's just he's been showing a lot of, you know, and if he learns to work with his teammates a little bit... Not that I'm... I hate to say that. He's not as bad as some people say as being like a one man.
He's got those OHL selfish tendencies that come out when
But I think part of that's just because he doesn't trust his teammates.
Well, yeah, he's the best player on the team.
I think the Sedins, though, have skated themselves into shape or something because they don't look nearly as slow as they did at the beginning. God. They look a lot better.
They looked like they had dull skates at the Brooklyn Brooklyn Islanders game.
And we jumped down on a lot of the older players' throats about being passed. But one guy, and they did blow a lead last night. We're talking about the games that they won. Mm-hmm. One guy the last few games that I've just loved what I've seen from him is Alex Burrows.
Oh, my God, I know.
Yeah, he's woken up. And,
he's not scoring, but he's like... I think Barchi's about to break out because of him, and I think Horvat's playing well because of him.
I love him.
He had the
Is
two
that a
game.
Line?
What? Yeah, Horvat.
Horvat, Bjarke, and
Burrows.
And
I think they debuted at the Stars game we were
in. Yeah, because I'm like, oh, so for the last week, Burrows has been playing really good.
And the Granlund-Erickson combination seems to be working, and Sutter with the Twins. Who saw that coming?
But
I think they've got to put him somewhere.
Burrows does have some assists in the past. Like, he has been getting... offensive numbers the past couple games.
But,
but you
are still
it upon...
doing the name thing?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay.
I was going to say Crosby could go as his last name.
Crosby, yeah?
Yeah.
I mean, it's kind of already like...
Sid.
JT.
Drop Sydney.
He was just in town.
JT.
Maybe it's because we have a friend named JT.
Or Justin... Oh, you mean Justin Timberlake?
Yeah. Ryan's good buddy, Justin Timberlake, used to direct hockey broadcasts.
I think Bo would be good as just Bo. JT would be good.
It'd be great, too, if someone like Wayne Simmons just went by Wayne, because, you know...
Hey,
he's
the Wayne.
Only Wayne worth...
We'll score by number 17, Wayne.
Corey Perry, if you just went by Corey, would sound like a 90s heartthrob.
Here's some things that
rhyme
with Corey.
See, these are such generic names, though. Someone like Kadri could go as Kadri.
Awesome.
Boone. Boone.
Just Boone Jenner. Boone.
We already refer to hockey players by their last name, though, so it kind of only works with the first name.
Or you just
drop... No, because we were talking about Brazilian soccer players, and some of them are... Those are just last names.
Like Nene. Yeah.
But I don't know. Like, that's not as creative to
Ichiro.
Me. It's like, you already refer to athletes by their last name all the time. Like,
you just have to drop their first name.
Yeah, but then you...
have to distinguish.
You wouldn't, in an interview, you wouldn't say... I'm sitting here with Crosby. I'm sitting here with Sidney Crosby.
The
so
hockey players aren't douchey enough to do that. Although I'm pretty sure Kessler would have an orgasm if somebody went, I'm sitting here with RK17.
That's the like so many hockey. I don't know. Like if you start to dive through hockey players' social media, about so many of these stupid hockey players have some sort of self-produced hat with a logo of their initials that kind of look like a number.
Right.
Like everybody does it.
They had a segment during the game last night.
Some of those hats are pretty good.
Designing their own ball caps
with New Era.
Canucks. And I think a couple of them, Erica Branson put his nickname on it.
There's
what he wants his nickname to be, Quads.
Quads.
Did you hear that?
Yeah,
he's 44, 4x4.
Well, we had to reshoot.
He's got good legs.
We had to reshoot that segment because the original one had JV18 in it.
Oh.
You proud Utica Comet. Now here's a segue. Nothing makes me happier.
Did he score a goal?
He had an assist last night. I don't know. Oh, sorry, Friday night. I don't know what he did Saturday night.
Mm-hmm.
But the fact that the Canucks are so banged up and Megna or whatever his name
and
is.
Chapu.
And
it was a Curtis Vogt goal that he set up too.
They need
to get somebody on that Utica Comets team who's like an actual guy we could call up who could score.
Darren Archibald. Jordan Subban.
Ugh. But there's just nothing down there.
Play Subban as a forward.
Maybe.
That being said, I'm glad that Hunter Shinkarak's not there anymore because the Canucks won the hell out of that trade. I like Marcus Granlund a lot. He had a couple of chances that he should have buried last night, but the fact that, like, A, he's in the NHL,
yeah.
And B, he's good enough to get those chances.
He's reminding me a little bit of Yannick Hansen now.
Yeah.
Good call.
Good.
Yes. Yeah. That great
Yannick.
The great trade.
What's happened to Shinkarak? Is he like the playground assistant for the Calgary Flames?
Not yet. Oh. Called him up though.
He's playing. He's a healthy scratch. He has four. He's played three games. He's got no points. He's a -4.
He's taking kids up for pizza and
so soccer. He hasn't quite been Hodgson.
I forgot to do something last night. I was gonna hunt down in the press box Gustav Forsling. To get some comments out of him.
Oh,
because he was there last night, but he wasn't on the ice.
Yeah, they said that we don't regret that trade.
How they could you regret
not?
It.
Yeah, he's good. Although now I don't see him. I don't see room for him on this roster. Like,
well, if Gustav Forsling was there, then it would be him or Stetcher. Like, I feel like they're very similar players, theoretically.
Trampkin, the third goal, some people are saying that it was his fault last night. I actually thought that was an interference penalty when he got hit at the blue line and coughed the puck up on the third goal. So, but like, I like what I see from him. Stetcher, they've kind of figured out his little sidestep move. But before you got here, we were talking about how like Taves kept blocking it.
Right.
Like Dikembe Mutombo.
Yeah.
Previously on the first 20 minutes of Pucks on.
But like, you know, with Tanev back, Edler's having he's not putting up points, but he looks a lot better than he has in a while defensively. There wouldn't have been room for Forsling on this team. He wouldn't have been in the top.
Somebody else would just not be here.
Well, he would just be in that slot. Stetcher might not have even been signed if you've got Forsling.
But he's a guy that is in Utica who's a viable option to be called up. That's the thing. Like that trade, like Clendenning continued to bounce around. Like Forsling, look, I don't know what.
Clendenning, he's playing big minutes in New York, baby.
Big minutes. Hartford for the Wolfpack.
Big minutes.
Wolfpack is back causing mass destruction.
Double zeros.
Although, yeah, we were kind of talking about this up in the box last night, though, where you look at that trade and then you look at the Granlund Shinkarak trade and they're all in the same vein with Benning's theory of like, you look at these guys that might not turn out. They might have a higher ceiling on them, like a Hunter Shinkarak or a Gustav Forsling. But they have a much steeper drop-off, and he's taking the guys that are less of a risk. And I don't know if I agree with that strategy all the way, but
I guess you win some, you lose some.
That is his general strategy, and he thinks overall you're going to get more value out of the Granlunds and the Clendennings. If you've got a bucket full of those, then you will out of these gut prospects that usually maybe only 1 in 5 work out.
But yeah, like I was
theoretically, I can see it, but I mean,
there is some cause for concern.
If you keep Forsling, you probably don't get Granlund in that trade, and you were just saying how much you like that.
But what did they see that I didn't see? This is what confuses me about NHL management types, because I feel like I'm not that stupid.
Yeah.
I watched Gustav Forsling in the World Juniors.
Yeah.
He was the best defenseman in the tournament.
Yeah. It was nonsensical.
What?
Clendenning was putting up numbers in the AHL inside. Like, I don't agree with it either.
Who cares?
Have made
a trade. Who cares?
I love Swedish players, but to play devil's advocate, I mean, Clendenning at the point, it's a similar...
Some guy named Stefan Giroux led the AHL in scoring 3 years in a row for Bakersfield. Guess where he is now? Still in Bakersfield at 31.
Clendenning was successful as a junior athlete as well. So
but
I mean,
we can all admit that that's... Jim Benning's one.
It's his theory.
It's, you know, that trade was his one black spot.
He's made some good deals. And yeah. I think the Sutter trade, I think that one's starting to show.
Well, because he didn't play all the last season. So,
and Bonino happened to become like very buzzy and America famous because he was playing on NBC every day. But like,
we talked about that. Like, if Sutter was still in the same third line center hole on the Pittsburgh Penguins, he probably would have done better than what Nick Bonino did.
Yeah, but
Shawn
Michaels wouldn't have come to the games.
There you go.
HBK.
So name drop, who were you talking to in the box last night?
Oh, geez, what's his name? Lucas, can't remember his last name.
Johansson?
No.
Spiza? No.
He is Finnish.
Oh, I know you're
talking. I'm totally blanking out on his name right now.
Rasmussen?
Sorry, Lucas. Yeah, anyway.
Was it Rasmussen?
No, that's...
I don't think that's
his
last name.
Well, I was talking to Alex Biega last night.
Yeah, he walked by me the other night when I was sitting next to the Rangers.
Did he acknowledge
injuries.
You?
He's working really hard. They got him doing stuff. He's filling out a lot of paperwork.
We talked. He's counting shifts like the backup goalie.
But he's doing something. Like, he is doing something. I walk because
he's keeping his mouth shut.
He's the perfect seventh defenseman.
Not going to complain.
Yeah.
Not going to rock the boat.
You can throw him into the game at any point this season. He'll probably give you a decent 60 minutes.
Serviceable. He's fine.
Yeah.
Yeah, I like him a lot. But yeah, like, this team, maybe they're fooling me because like the last six games haven't been terrible. Like, you get Tanev back,
You get Hansen back.
Hansen back, man, they don't look so bad anymore.
If Sven Berchi starts scoring goals,
if and buts for fruit and nuts every day, be f-ing Christmas.
Christmas is just around the corner.
But does Hansen come back and have issues like Burrows did after his foot injury? Do you like? You never know.
Maybe, but like Chaput and Megna, that's scary.
But as long
that's
as...
That's scary.
Like a good scary?
No, like bad.
Chaput on the fourth line, I don't think I mind that much.
Good scary.
No, there is a good thing about those guys playing.
He hasn't
playing.
Been great, but like...
There's no one else. That's my point. There's no one else.
No, he shouldn't be playing in your top nine. Like, and Megna, yeah, I don't know.
This is a guy you don't want playing in your top 12, all right? I love the fact that those two guys are playing, and Jake is still down in Shelbyville or wherever the Comets play.
Utica.
Thank God, because we've had a couple of terrible scares this week, and that was Jake Virtanen getting called up to get his stuff, which was an official quote.
I like Willie, but I feel like there needs to be somebody standing next to him.
You
going,
know what?
Oh, that, we you, don't. What? Why are you saying that?
You know what I found? Find out. I think it is. I was talking about this week. Is like you got a rookie. You got a guy doing his first job time being NHL president. You got a guy his first time as an NHL GM, and you got a guy first time NHL coach.
Okay.
They need some sort of media training because they say just nonsensical. Should you be saying that? Should you be saying that in the media?
We call them up so you can get his stuff.
Yeah. And it's like, what? I picture they asked Willie that as he's like trying to like juggle all this coffee or something in his hands, like to get to his car. It's like, oh yeah, we had to get his stuff. He's got his stuff. And then Ray Ferraro tweeted, it's like, they were on a six-game roadie. Trust me, he had enough stuff. So I don't know what I don't know if he had to go and he didn't want his pies to, he had to put the pies in the freezer or something.
But they were cooling on the windowsill. The Coyotes were going to just come and eat them.
Just to cut that out.
But why did you allude to that? We'll edit this out too.
Because I want you to cut it all out.
He will. Just tell
him. Explain the comment.
Not on tape.
I'm not going to put it up. I've done this.
I'll tell you later.
Okay.
Jeez.
I think we should leave that in. That was good radio.
I'll tell you later. New cold open. Cut it out. Just cut it out.
Why? I'll tell you later.
Jeez. People are always mad at us.
Very polarized.
No one knows what I know, but I've told you guys, right? I think anyway.
I don't know.
Who are you, the guy behind WikiLeaks?
Julian Assange?
Question here from the Twitter.
Is he still locked up in that embassy?
Are you thinking of...
Isn't it the other guy?
No, Snowden's in the hotel.
Oh, okay.
Anyway, sorry, Ryan.
Across from the Kremlin.
I'll avoid that question. Are we all happy that Evander Kane's not a Canuck?
And apparently those talks are dead. The Canucks have come to their senses and went, whoa.
They could revive that stuff.
Just go a week without scoring a goal and hey, Chris Tanev, huh? The
Rogers Arena will be about as safe a space for Evander Kane as the Hamilton theater was for Mike Pence.
They harassed him.
Did we talk about that?
No.
They did not harass him.
They gave a civil speech to him.
It was really polite.
Yes.
I thought it was great. And it was kind of a strange thing for him to be there in the first place.
They said it was...
Knowing what we know about Mike Pence, it was kind of an odd choice.
Free tickets?
They said it was a smoke bomb because Ivanka Trump went to Japan.
What? No, it was a smoke bomb because that morning, Donald Trump paid off all of his... Trump University.
Yeah,
the
$25 million.
I don't settle. I win cases in court.
So they're boycotting Hamilton, the Republican Party, but the Republican Party, none of them would go to a musical and admit it. They all do it, you know, wearing big hats and
fake mustaches.
No,
I'm not here to see the arts.
So they're just going to keep doing what they do when they go to see a musical. They're going to hide it, the fact that they're actually theirs. Yeah, boycott Hamilton. Oh, I love Sweeney Todd. It's the greatest musical I've ever seen.
Republicans need to go to the theater like they need another hole in the head.
I think they should go to the theater more. Yeah.
So I was so afraid of Evander Kane being a Canuck this week that I got...
I wouldn't sit in the Wilkes booth, though. It's not a good sign.
But bum.
I got there was a fake Twitter account that looks like the Canucks that tweeted out.
Yeah,
official.
You said that to me. I was at the office.
I texted everybody. I'm like, yeah, fuck Evander Kane. And then I did, minute later, fuck, I got trolled. I was so concerned that they would do it.
But that shows how you truly felt. You were excited.
You're excited for an Evander Kane stint as a Canucks player, like how some people are excited just to see how crazy things are going to get in the States. It's going to be a train wreck, but it'll be something to watch.
Oh, yeah. I'd be all over that.
Yeah. The Sedins would just be... I forget who I was texting with, but it's like if he...
Would you throw a Kane jersey on the ice?
He misses practice because of an all-nighter at Gorgamish and then Suhang's Village, drinking the cold tea.
Which is beer.
Like, it's like some people are like, oh, well, if he comes to Vancouver, like, he'll be around family and maybe he'll straighten himself out. I think he'll come to Vancouver and he'll be around his shithead friends.
Yeah.
And things will get worse.
He has shithead friends that will want to party with him all the time.
He needs to go somewhere where there's nothing else to do but play hockey. Like Buffalo.
Oh.
No.
Or Winnipeg, maybe?
Or Winnipeg. Although everybody gets in trouble in Buffalo. Evander Kane gets in trouble in Buffalo. Patrick Kane gets in a lot of trouble in Buffalo.
But those are the Kane
the
brothers.
The Stahl brothers got in trouble in
the
Buffalo.
Kane family is notorious.
No, the Stahls got arrested.
Hey, you know, since the beginning of time, the Kane family has been notorious for just getting into trouble.
Something about Niagara
nothing
Falls.
Nothing has changed.
You see that water rushing down? It just makes you want to punch cab drivers and grope women. I don't know what it is.
Who was the commissioner of the NHL back when Kane pulled that behind
God?
Was God the commissioner of the NHL when he did the Bertuzzi to Abel? Was that Sunday chatter?
Just
on
a
the
fine.
Podcast?
Just a fine.
I think it was Judas. I think Judas was the commissioner.
No, he came
no,
after.
No, that was many, many years after.
That's another testament altogether.
Because it is Sunday and we were recording it. Oh. Oh. Yeah.
He could go all the way.
There we go. Lost my headphones.
Ottawa is in control.
Does anybody care that if the BC Lions win today, they're in the Grey Cup? Does anybody care at all?
A lot of people do care. No one in this room, probably.
We'll do a Grey Cup podcast, probably.
I'll watch it just because there'll be chicken wings.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah, I could go for some chicken wings.
Yeah.
Since we are recording in the middle of the morning, Pagani asked what our favorite type of brunch food is, and she says there is a correct answer.
Of course, with Pagani, there's a correct answer.
It's black and white.
Well... I went with an egg and cheese sandwich from Tim Hortons.
Is that the best one?
From Tim Hortons?
Brunch?
Yeah. And I guess I developed a taste for their coffee.
Oh, no.
Their stuff's not bad, but I don't know if I'd go out of my way to pick that up.
I like to go Latin if I can, and I'll go with a really well-done huevos rancheros.
Oh, that's good, yeah. Paul?
Geez. I've been on an eggs kick the past little, you know, couple of years. Omelets or whatever. But French toast is always a good one.
French toast is a dark horse.
Don't overdo it, but some French toast with some sausage or bacon on the side.
The distillery does a really good meatball hash with a fried egg.
Yeah, that's where we're going to go for brunch.
Oh boy.
I'm a classic. I really like a proper, well done, not too gross eggs benedict. And that's only because I only liked Eggs Benedict in like 2012.
I had the best Eggs Benedict of my entire life last week. For my birthday, Mrs. Dave took me out to Ask for Luigi for brunch.
Okay, yeah.
If you've ever been there, it's kind of on the outskirts of Gastown. It's kind of in a weird area. It's near the Alibi Room.
Mm-hmm.
Amazing.
Really?
Amazing. Yeah. The food there is terrific. All of it is good. It's huge. It's going to be great. It's great.
I think we'll wrap up this with why we have a new dude of the week. Who was our last one? Was it Max Domi?
Max Domi. Now it's Russell Wilson of the Seattle Seahawks.
Now, Paul, we were worried about saying this at the beginning of the podcast when you weren't here because we'd worry about an eye-rolling mic drop because our dude of the week is a football player.
Yeah, I don't like that at all.
Well,
but it's hockey-related.
It is hockey-related.
Loosely.
And, well, you know, and it is, but... As you know, like they're trying to build an arena in Seattle to bring back Sonics.
Oh, okay, yeah.
And they're trying.
I heard about this.
To bring an NHL team back.
Okay.
And
the Seattle Metropolitans.
Yes.
I hope. That would be great.
That'd be a great IHOP.
That's a good breakfast.
any breakfast food is good breakfast food, I think, just to close that.
I got about five names for the Seattle team that would all be good.
Yeah.
The Rain.
Mm-hmm.
I like that one.
Is the
Seattle team going to have a name before Las Vegas does?
Probably. Yeah.
the Bombers. I like the Bombers because of all the Boeing.
What about the Pilots?
Planes. The Pilots. They had a failed baseball team called the Pilots.
They're the
Brewers
now.
That might be kind of be nice. Yeah, the Pilots. The Seattle Snotty Baristas.
And the Seattle Nintendos.
How about the Seattle I'm With Her?
Red Blacks.
They voted for.
Or the Bernies.
The Seattle Burns or the Seattle Sasquatch.
Oh yeah, Sasquatch is one that's come up before, and I really like
Sasquatch. Actually,
Sasquatch is an amazing mascot.
Yeah.
Logo potential.
Yeah.
You don't need this anymore, do you, Kootenai Ice? Thank you.
Well, like the name of the mascot could be Harry.
All
works. The Seattle Sasquatch, and I would go with the same color scheme as all the other teams. I would go dark blue, the hot green, and the gray. I would keep that same as the Sounders and the Seahawks.
Well, if you go Sasquatch, brown is an underutilized color in the NHL.
Does
that
anybody
make
in
for
the
an interesting jersey?
It's worth it just for the mascot.
Who goes brown?
Hmm. Although the mascot
brown with some green and blue highlights, maybe just green. I don't know how that would work, but
it would be
that's the Vancouver Grizzlies' legacy to sports. Is I think that Super Grizz was one of the best mascots ever.
Well, yeah, he had that trampoline, and he would dunk so hard.
He'd come to all the local high schools.
Don't do drugs, kids.
Did he come to your high school?
He did.
He came to ours, too, with Sharif.
Yeah.
Please
come see us. Please. tickets.
Is that confetti? No, those are tickets.
Come
Colorable.
See us play the Sacramento Kings on a Tuesday. No one's there.
I live too far out in the boonies. They never visited us.
Yeah,
in,
I never.
South Surrey, White Rock.
And I was in Calgary at the time, and I didn't get anything.
They didn't get out to Calgary?
They played an exhibition game.
The Naismith Cup.
Oh,
it probably
the
was.
Raptors.
They used to play the Raptors in exhibition.
Yeah, and they would play all across Canada. But I remember they came to the Saddle Dome for...
Edmonton's making a comeback.
So back to Russell Wilson. He's partnered with the Sonics Arena Group and hopes to bring back the NBA and an NHL team to Seattle.
Okay.
Which is unlike my beloved Seattle Mariners, who are kind of being dicks and preventing. They're trying to block an arena being built in the south of downtown district, the SoDo district.
Uh-huh.
Two professional sports teams competing, I can see why they would be concerned.
It would be four in that area. There's the sound.
I know, but if you're adding two in like in a very short amount of time, that's a huge...
Baseball.
But the NBA and the NHL don't play at the same time that the Mariners do, and the Mariners rarely ever, never play in October.
you're still talking about like annual amounts of money that people have to spend.
It's,
and
a, hot
theoretically,
sport. It's a hot sports town. They can handle it.
Yeah,
I think so too, but I can see why they would be concerned.
They love their sports. Mm. There's room for everybody. I really believe that there is room for everybody in Seattle. I think it's a stone cold winner.
Well, there's a big population in there from from Everett all the way down to south of Tacoma. Like, there's a lot of people in that area.
I think hockey's a slam dunk in Seattle, and I think that basketball is a slam dunk in Seattle. What happened to them was tragic.
Look
what
they
never have lost.
Look what they did with the Sounders. Like, they get 30,000 people for a soccer game.
Sounders, the Seahawks, even the Mariners, like, when they're hot, you know, they're
the Mariners had good attendance this year. They'd get 35,000 on the weekend.
And Seattle has a strong hockey tradition. They the first American city to win the Stanley Cup.
Yes.
Yeah. In fact, Russell Wilson, in his Players Tribune article, he mentioned that, yes, he goes, the NBA needs that green and gold black back. Seattle needs basketball back and hockey, too. Metropolitans won the Stanley Cup in 1917, in case you didn't know.
Was it 17 or was it 11?
I don't know. It's Russell Wilson's from Virginia. How do you know?
He probably fact-checked the Google.
Yeah.
I can't remember. Yeah, it might be 17, actually. I don't know why I'm thinking 11.
Well, he spent half the Players Tribune article talking about how much he loved NBA Jam, so we'll say that.
I'm rooting for Seattle. I hope they get a team. I think it'll be fun. I'm excited for Vegas. It's weird that they don't have a name.
No.
Enough.
I just wanted to read...
Enough already.
I just wanted to read this. This is why he's due to the week.
Yeah.
I'll read... he goes, to me, this is about more than nostalgia. We live in divisive times, and sports is a way of bringing people closer together. They allow all of us, children and adults, to use our imaginations and dream. I want kids in Seattle to grow up dreaming of playing basketball or hockey in their hometown team. If you doubt the power of sports to unify people, just look at the Chicago after the Cubs' amazing World Series victory. It made me think of our own parade through Seattle after we won the Super Bowl in 2014. It was 25 degrees Fahrenheit in the middle of February, and I was standing on a float, looking out at the crowd. That's where it all slowed down and everything sunk into me. I tried to focus on every single face. Even though it was impossible to take it all in, I saw people of every race, black, white, brown, everything. I saw men and women. I saw old folks crying and young kids who'd obviously skip school. All walks of life braved the cold that day just to be a part of something. All those people had two things in common. They were smiling like it was the happiest day of their life, and they were all one color, bright green. And so I thought that was a really nice little thing.
Basketball and hockey are going to make Seattle great again.
Sounds great. Yeah, no, they won in 17 and Victoria was 25. Mm. That was when we had the Pacific Northwest dominant power.
We've talked about it before. That's the Patrick family bringing world-class hockey to the West Coast.
Yep.
Are we about wrapped up?
That's wrapping it up.
Just wanted to, on a serious note... we're dedicating this show to former Vancouver Giants captain Craig Cunningham.
Oh, I know. If you don't know,
he collapsed during the pregame yesterday in Tucson, playing a game against the Moose. They canceled the game. Details are sketchy. We don't really know what his condition is right now, but yeah.
That's terrifying.
Anybody who's ever met Craig Cunningham has nothing but wonderful things to say about him. Steve Ewan has a nice article in The Province today about when Steve had cancer, that Cunningham was coming to see him on a fairly consistent basis.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And Lucic had a bunch of nice things to say about him this morning as well.
Brandon Leipzig reached out just about every player of his, and they had to cut his jersey open on the ice. Like, it's terrifying. And I think he's 26 or so.
He's been a captain at the AHL level for the past three seasons.
So he is that kind of hockey player.
So anyway, Craig, you know, your Pucks on Net crew is rooting for you. Mm-hmm. We hope all is well. Go Tucson. If I could move, you know, I would try to tell you.